Chapter 23. Guerrilla King of No Man's Land. It was Independence Day in Kabul. For the past week, swashbuckling clan chiefs from every part of Afghanistan had been swaggering through the decorated bazaars, killing time between one gigantic feast and the next, watching the rough and tumble of the fierce rugby on horseback, which is called buzkashi, and played with up to 100 a side. The mountain kingdom's capital echoed to the passing and repassing of gun carriages, jackbooted elite guards, wild horsemen from the north, cheers for the dashing young king, Mohammed Zahir Shah. At night, throughout the three-day celebrations, stretched by popular demand unofficially to nearer 10, fireworks and floodlighting of the royal palace provided a real treat for mountain warriors, fleece-coated Uzbeks and dreamy-eyed nomads from far-off Turkestan. I had been in Afghanistan just 3 months, seeking the fakir of Ipi everywhere, but there seemed no trace. I knew that he had escaped yet again from the Pakistan side of the southern borderland, that a Pathan government had been set up somewhere in the free land this side of the Khyber. How to find the fakir, even though the very streets of this city swarmed with his clansmen, his close supporters, was still a mystery. In Pakistan, nobody knew anything about the fakir. Go to Kabul, he is hand in glove with the Afghans. In the Afghan capital, there was friendship, cooperation, green tea and parties. There was no fakir of Ipi. We do not know where Ipi is. Foreign journalists have been waiting months to get a lead on him. One man here, who had never left Kabul, spent days penciling his exclusive story on the theory that nobody had interviewed the fakir, probably nobody ever would, and he might get away with it in some American paper. I meet the mad fakir, plenty of local colour, and you're home, he told me. There was no doubt that the average Afghan was pro-fakir to the end. Capturing the popular imagination as the daredevil will-o'-the-wisp whom none could see, whose exploits had for 30 years rung from one end of the frontier to the other, Ipi was certainly hero number one to them. But none of them had met him. The grim-browed Pathans of the free land between Pakistan and Afghanistan might come to Kabul, were to be seen sauntering through the streets, of their leader they would not speak at all. One night I was invited to a feast held in honour of a visiting chief, Yakub Khan. Within the immense embroidered Tatar tent, Herati carpets and silk bolsters were our seats. Some 300 people sat cross-legged around the colourful, brown and red-woven tablecloths spread with costly aromatic pilau, golden chickens peeping shyly from the mounds of yellow-tinted rice. Several hours and some gallons of green tea later, full and weary, I followed Yakub to the garden for the bonfire sword dance, surrounded by turbaned warriors hanging with every variety of offensive weapon that they found portable. I was trying to keep up with the Khan's appetite for dried fruit and his homemade jokes when he spoke to me in the rough Pushtu of the mountains. Persian was the best I could do. Pushtu was really too much.
You don't know Pushtu?
Not to speak, certainly not the Waziri dialect.
How could you talk to Ipi then?
I understood that an approach was being made. In Persian.
I see. Do you know my clan?
I told him that I knew that he was a Waziri.
Yes, but I am a Turizai. This is Ipi's own branch of the Waziris.
The craggy, bearded face, topped by a carelessly tied black turban, came close to mine.
If you are a traitor, you will die after being toasted.
This was something right out of a scriptwriter's imagination. I told the Khan that I wanted to see the fakir and that I had no opinion at all about him, except that I knew of his bravery in leading his supporters during 20 years of frontier war.
The fakir will see you at Gruik, When Yaja Guljan comes, you will know the time. The country is full of spies. If you come, you must swear on your blood to tell no military information except what we allow you. You can stay 3 days at Gruik. You will have to spend at least a month in Kabul after you return from there. During that time, our people will watch you. Fair enough, I thought. A lifetime of intrigue and frontier raiding had certainly taught the fakir a thing or two about undercover work. I was beginning to feel more than ever like an international spy. The suspense was acute. There was the fear that this was just a joke, either by someone who knew my quest, or even by the fakir himself. 3 days passed, without any sign of Guljan, whoever he might be. I took long walks through Mulberry Gardens, along the magnificent tree-lined road to Dar el Aman, into the mountain valley of Pagman. Nobody seemed to be following me. On the third evening, Guljan came. I was sitting in my usual cafe, surrounded by hookah-smoking bravos from the Black Mountain. An immense figure, shoulders like the side of a house, the traditional scar on his left cheek, and one shoulder bent with the weight of a lifetime's rifle carrying, sat down beside me. As he shouted, "Ho, Bacha, bring pink tea," I found a folded scrap of country-made paper being pressed into my hand. Gul finished his cardamom tea in one gulp. Without looking at me, he swaggered out, in the direction of the gunsmith's bazaar, a snub sten swinging idly from his belt. Back in my apartment, I read the message, with its cursive monogram of the fakir. I was to go to the frontier, alone, unarmed, to a point where independent territory bulges into Afghanistan. Hiring a car for this ghastly, jolting trip, I was there within 18 hours. Under the shadow of a loaf-shaped rock in this defile, miles from anywhere, an ancient shepherd sat. He took charge of the car and asked to see what writing I was carrying. I passed it to him. From behind the rock he produced a white cotton square and laid it on the ground. As the gloaming crept over the mountain glens, a posse of 6 Pathans rode up. With the ends of their turbans held between their teeth in brigand style, they had the real air of freeborn frontier men. In 2 minutes I was sitting, blindfolded, on their led horse. We plodded up stiff, boulder-strewn gradients for an hour and a half. Then my eyes were uncovered. We were in a cup-shaped valley between the ranges, eerie in the light of the full moon. Inside a long, low fort built against the narrow entrance to this depression, I lay down gratefully on a bare straw palliasse and slept. In spite of the sheepskin postin coat that covered me, the freezing cold woke me just before dawn streaked the sky. As I stirred, a guard in riding boots with bandoliers crossed over a leather jerkin brought me pomegranate juice and hot water he had boiled over a charcoal fire. I pulled aside the padded cotton curtain from the window's empty frame. All around the valley hoar frost gleamed over the vividly green turf. At one end a small wood carried a stream westward. On every side, where the cliffs rose sharply, grey granite buildings, creeper-clad in most cases, followed the contours of the rocks. Several hundred men, fully armed, stood motionless, facing Meccawards at their daybreak prayer, their husky frames dwarfing the prayer leader a pace or two in front. "Rais-e-Jamhur, President of the Republic," said the guard. This was my first glimpse of Mirza Haji Ali Khan, the fakir of Ipi. 2 men in fur caps, breeches and half-boots entered the guardhouse. In tunics which seemed to be modelled on the American type, they bore every indication of an organised military force. Embroidered shoulder flashes carried the Pushtanistan insignia of a mountain with a sun rising behind it. They introduced themselves as officers of the elite Old Guard, recently formed from those Pathan guerrillas with Indian or Afghan army experience. Major Asaf, one of the fakir's retinue, had read an earlier book of mine, partly based on some of the fakir's exploits. He shook me warmly by the hand. I believe that it was probably through him that I had my chance of seeing Gruick at all. A jeep, originally carried by human hands to the mountain stronghold, took me across the valley, past three anti-aircraft batteries, to the simple wooden house where the fakir lives when he is at home. A radio mast protruded from the roof. Green-dyed canvas draped the frame as camouflage against Pakistani reconnaissance planes. On the door, charmingly framed in a neat arabesque design, were inscribed the businesslike words, "Mirza Haji Ali Khan, President of Free Pushtunistan." A six-footer with fixed bayonet presented arms as we approached. I eyed the grenade and sticks of explosive in his belt with some apprehension. Pathans are nothing if not careless about personal safety. Just inside the door stood the fakir himself. A slight, fair-skinned, brown-bearded man, he could easily pass for a European. He wore baggy trousers, chaply wrapped over sandals, and an embroidered waistcoat over a military tunic. "Welcome to Gruick." He took both my hands in his. "Stare Marche, may you never be tired," the traditional Pathan greeting. A fire burned in the large timbered room. On the walls, maps of the neighbouring countries were pinned, beside a revolver and a prayer carpet hung on one side. We sat down on bolsters to share a breakfast of meat and yogurt, with tea from a charcoal-fed samovar. The fakir's eyes twinkled. He seemed so small, so delicately made, that I found it hard to believe that this was the most renowned warrior among a race of fighters. "You are the first non-Pathan to come to Gruick. Not many, even of our own people, can get here, but I hope that before long things will be different." One by one, the rulers of this strange guerrilla state of 3 million people came on their morning visit to the chief. I met Mullah Sher Ali Khan, advisor on national defense, with a smart uniform under his sheepskin coat. He immediately spoke of repeated aerial bombardments by Pakistan, which have almost razed Gruick more than once. Those anti-aircraft guns were captured from them not far from Peshawar in 49 and brought up here piece by piece. At mid-morning, I toured the arms factory, concealed in a honeycomb of caves tunneled out of the rock, probably prehistoric metal mines. Using electricity from wind power and sometimes hand-powered lathes, Afridi clansmen were laboriously turning out replicas of British Lee Enfields. I picked one up. It was perfect, even to the monogram GR and a crown. But in addition were the words, "Free Pushtunistan." A single light rocket gun on the principle of the Sobbing Sisters weapon was shown to me as of a type under construction. In place of the batteries which ignited the projectile in the original model, this one seemed to be intended to work by some sort of flint and steel mechanism, not unlike a petrol lighter. As each weapon was completed and tested, it was taken to the nearby range where recruits, some of them boys of 15 or so, were being trained. Claiming that the fakir bore a charmed life, the advisor showed me several bombs which, he said, had landed near him and which had failed to explode. I was determined to get the story of Epi's life, but he was reluctant to talk about himself. "I do not count," his small soft hands incessantly telling his rosary. "There is nothing unusual about me. I am 48 years old, was born in Kasora in the center of the free land. My father was a holy man, that may be why I am now called the fakir. I am a soldier, though I originally studied Islamic law. When I had memorized the entire Quran, I turned to the study of modern Western science. For 16 years, I led Pathans against the Indo-British armies on the frontier. I have never felt any rancor against Britain as such, of course. It was just my duty to help our people to hold their own. I used sometimes to spend periods in British India and quite liked it." The fakir sighed. "I do not dislike the Pakistanis either. but the British and I understood one another. I am sure that you will find thousands of people in England today who know this. The fact that there was once a price of £6,000 on his head and nobody ever claimed it greatly amused him. That was during the British days. I wonder whether the offer still holds. While his officers were, without exception, hard-bitten mountain fighters, the fakir himself struck me again and again as strangely gentle, a dreamer who was only incidentally a soldier. His political acumen is famed. We have no support of any kind from any outside power at all. We want to develop our country and to guarantee its independent statehood. There are 3 million of us here, and several million more out by the border and now in what is called Pakistan. Many more are in Afghanistan. Our country has great mineral riches, and by any definition of international law, we are sovereign in our own territory. Let us join the other nations as free men. This is one reason why our fighters went into Kashmir, to draw attention to our claims. As nothing was done, I called off almost all the holy warriors from the Kashmir front. He spoke at length about alleged broken promises and many more political matters. I spent most of those 3 days touring the town and asking questions. Meanwhile, the fakir was busied in meeting delegations of tribal elders, leading the prayers and giving discourses. The Minister of the Interior, Maulavi Zahir Shah Khan, showed me the caverns, equipped with rations and beds, where the women and children sheltered during air raids. In several discussions, the fakir and his officers outlined their plans to me. Independent territory, they said, was becoming fairly well organized. Vendettas and the like had nearly been stopped. In the place of the blood feud, the fakir had instituted the Brotherhood Pact. Pakistan attacks, I was told, were designed to contain the Pathans and prevent them from attacking Peshawar and other towns near the border. But the Pathans claimed to be organizing for another reason. They had set up a national assembly and had a regular army. The state is short of money, and most revenue goes in arms and provisions. The EP espionage system extends throughout Afghanistan and Pakistan, where millions of Pathans live or work. Allegations that the Pathans were being helped by India were dismissed as rubbish. "Do I eat the salt of the infidel, worshipper of sticks and stones?" roared the fakir himself when I spoke of this story I had heard in Karachi. His face was working, and he looked much more like a brigand chief at that moment. Supplies such as petrol and manufactured goods needed in the capital of Gruik and other parts of Pushtanistan are smuggled through the many small passes north and south of the Khyber, and probably also from well-wishers in Afghanistan. The information service of the mountain capital is trying to get hold of a really powerful radio transmitter. At the present moment, there are only a few small army sets in use. Other communications are by carrier pigeon or couriers like Gul Khan. Apart from the old guard veterans, several other formations exist. I watched some of the irregulars drilling under a Pathan former sergeant of the Khyber Rifles. At one end of the parade ground, which is also a hockey field for the AA gun crews, stands the war memorial. This takes the form of a grey stone slab. On it is cut the inscription in Pushto and Arabic, "Remember them who were martyrs for your freedom, from before Alexander the Great until Allah wills." The rank and file of the guerrillas come nearer to the usual conception of a brigand chief plus pirate than anything I have seen elsewhere. Without exception, they are armed to the teeth. The typical garb is high boots or sandals, baggy trousers, tunic shirt, and tight-tied turban. This latter is also the warrior's shroud, and he carries it even when wearing a fur cap on the frozen mountain slopes. Military uniforms of every kind are greatly in vogue, but only regular troops may wear the copper badges with the mountain and sun emblem. The general attitude of these Pathans is still that of the freebooter, the soldier of fortune. Few of them seem to care about the weightier implications of independent statehood. When I asked them about freedom, They usually replied that they were already free and always had been as individuals. Their collective war aims are left to the fakir and other leaders. Perhaps the most surprising thing about this only guerrilla state in the world is that the fakir has managed to get so many different clans to work together. For centuries, these Afridis, Wazirs, Mohmans, and the rest were at one another's throats. If this unity stays, there is no knowing what new force may develop in no man's land. Neither Afghanistan nor Pakistan rules the belt of territory running between their boundaries. Each country is interested in it as a frontier problem. Neither, so far, has officially recognized the fakir and his government. It will perhaps be a long time before either does so. In any case, the determination and persistence with which these Pathans are trying to form some sort of unified community amid the barren rocks of their homeland is something probably unique today. The fakir told me that he had received many offers from adventurers who wanted to join his ranks, but he would not say whether he had recruited any of them. On the third day, I was taken by another route out of the Pathan capital, with small gifts presented by the fakir. One of them was a silver dagger inscribed Free Pushtanistan. Another was a red and green national flag, with the mountain and sunrise emblem embroidered on it in silk. Most of all, I appreciated the fakir's invitation to come again when we have our complete freedom. Then you will see what real hospitality is. Back in Kabul, people who heard that I had been to see the legendary fakir treated me almost with apprehension, and there is no doubt that I was watched for the rest of my stay there by the odd idler who always seemed to be around. But I had met the fakir of Ipi and seen Pushtanistan in action. That was what mattered. My self-imposed mission was ended. I could look back upon almost 2 years of wanderings, several tight corners, but 100% success score. What had started out as a quest to see and record some of the world's remaining challenges of the East had, by its very success, whetted my appetite for more. I sat down in Kabul's biting winter to write up my notes. My never-failing companion lay beside me. Until my wanderings were due to start again, Robot F2.8 lay snugly in its case. A request. If you enjoyed this book, please review it on Amazon and Goodreads. Reviews are an author's best friend. To stay in touch with news on forthcoming editions of Idris Shah Works, please sign up for the mailing list at bit.ly/ISFlist. And to follow him on social media, please go to any of the following links. twitter.com/IdrisShah, facebook.com/IdrisShah, youtube.com/IdrisShah999, pinterest.com/IdrisShah, bit.ly/isgoodreads, and idrisshah.tumblr.com. Or you can find the main website at idrisshahfoundation.org. That was Destination Mecca by Idris Shah. First published 1964, published in this edition 2016. This work is copyright the estate of Idris Shah, all rights reserved. This audiobook has been narrated by David Ault.